Good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon.
I officially welcome you all to the historical Cape Coast Castle. My name is Harry, and I'll be your guide. The tour will take us about 45 minutes. And throughout this 45 minutes, we shall visit the male slave dungeon, the female slave dungeon, the condemned cell, the punishment cell, the courtyard of the castle, the door of no return, the door of return. From there, we move upstairs, see the Palaver Hall, where buying and selling of human beings took place. From there, we bring the guided tour to an end. But before we begin with the tour of the castle, I'm going to give you a brief history about the castles we have in Ghana and then the transatlantic slave trade on the west coast of Africa. Basically, in Ghana, there are three castles dotted along the coast of Ghana. We have St. George's Castle in Elimina, built by the Portuguese in 1482. We also have the Christiansborg Castle in Osu, Accra, built by the Danes in 1661. Finally, we have Cape Coast Castle, built by the British in 1665. And so, out of these three castles, Elimina Castle or the St. George's Castle, it is the biggest and the oldest European structure in tropical West Africa. Cape Coast Castle, where we are at the moment, it is the smallest among the three. However, Cape Coast Castle itself, it was once built as a fort known as the Karlsberg Fort by the Swedish in 1653. Later, the Danes came in for the Swedish, they fought them and drove them away, so they took in charge of the fort. The Dutch also came in, they also fought the Danes and also drove them away. Following the subsequent Anglo-Dutch War between the British and then the Dutch, the British also came in, they also fought the Dutch, defeated them, and then took away the fort. So basically, it was the British who developed the fort into a castle status as we've seen today. And so Cape Coast Castle, as it exists today, it was built over a period of 300 years. However, slavery in Africa, it all started at a time when the Spaniards got to what they called the New World. Upon getting to the New World, gold and silver mines were opened. Sugar, tobacco, cotton plantations were established. Inasmuch they wanted the wealth from the New World, they were not prepared to do the hard labor. They subjected the natives to do the hard labor. Due to European diseases, the natives were not surviving. They needed to get people to replace the natives. One Catholic missionary by name Bartolomeo de las Cascas, he suggested that blacks taken from Africa should be made to work in the plantations. In his opinion, he said Africans, they were doing the same work under similar climatic condition in Africa, and then also Africans are much stronger. For that reason, blacks should be made to work in the plantation. Somewhere around 1512, they took a couple of black people from Spain to Española. Others also say to Santo Domingo. That is where they were tested on the plantations, and then true to Bartolomeo de las Cascas' claim, they all proved to be physically strong, which made the demand for black people rise. And this began the unfortunate story of misery and pain of black people, the forced exodus of blacks and Africans from their motherland to the world unknown. The trade wasn't in Ghana only. The whole of West Africa, from wherever that these enslaved Africans were captured along West Africa, they would have to walk barefooted to their castles. But before they were brought down to their castles, they were first of all taken to Asumansun slave market. That is where these enslaved Africans took their last African bath. But please remember, not everyone went to the slave market. Those of the captives who went to the slave market would have to come from a specific direction. Those of the captives who were being captured from the northern part of the country, like Tamale, Kumasi, Salaga, Techiman, they were the ones who would have to go through Asumansun. Anybody coming from different angle would also have to use different slave markets. And so those coming from the northern part of the country, they walk, they get to a village called Asumansun. Within the village, you can locate a river called the Oche River. That is where the captives were made to take their last African bath. And so the whole concept about the slave market was that it was because they've walked several miles before getting to that very spot. Many of them were tired, others were dirty. And so there was a need for them to allow them to take their bath, shave them, apply pomade on them, just for the old to appear younger in order to attract higher prices when they get to the castle. That was the whole concept about the slave market. From there, others came in here. Others too might continue the journey to the Elmira Castle. It all depends on who went there to buy who. If it is a British, they move down to this castle. If it is a Portuguese, they continue the journey to the Elmira Castle. But just inside the castle, the captives were being branded with the branded irons. Why were they being branded? It is because different slave companies were buying the captives. These companies wanted to identify whoever they were going to be bought. And so they introduced a branding iron. A branding iron, it is a metal. Mm-hmm. Just on top of the metal, the slave company has its name or probably has a company's logo on top of the metal. Mm-hmm. All they would have to do is to insert the metal stick into fire to get very hot. Mm-hmm. Once they pick the stick from the fire, they place it straight on their chest, at their arm, or at their back for easy identification. The branding alone was even enough to kill them. After that has been done, they were then separated. The men were kept down here, whilst the women were also kept in the female slave dungeon. Why in the dungeons? In the dungeons because these dungeons served as a transit point for the captives. They need to stay down here from 2 weeks to 3 months, depending on when the slave ships will get to the coast. Once the slave ship gets to the coast, they will have to transport all the captives to the Americas and the Caribbean. The lives of Jamaica, Brazil, Argentina, Trinidad and Tobago, Guyana, Haiti, Dominican Republic, Virginia, New York, only few others were taken to Europe. Over there, they auctioned the captives. They sell them out to plantation owners for them to work in their newfound plantations. The trade officially ended in England in 1807, but then those of the British inside this very edifice, they refused to end the trade in 1807, but then they rather continued with the trade till 1833, which was finally abolished in here. The trade lasted for more than 400 years, more than 4 centuries. So I'm going to pause for a while. If there are questions you'd love to ask, please do so before we begin with the talk.
I think the
question.
We are still in shock.
Yes.
So we're going to move down. The floor slows a bit slippery in here. Let us take our time.
Okay.
These are bent bricks. Mm-hmm. These are supposed to be the original floor mm-hmm. of the dungeon, not this.
Okay.
And so on top of the original floor, all these are human feces, blood, vomit, covering the original floor of the dungeon. And so with the exception of the first chamber where we stood on the original floor, in here we are not standing on the original floor of the dungeon. Rather, we are standing on the remains of the captives.
Mm-hmm.
This bit. That is the very last chamber. Naturally, this part of the chamber, it is naturally brighter as compared to the remaining chambers. Because of this open space up here, from this very point, not everyone will continue the journey from this point. From this point, they need to separate the weaker ones from the stronger ones. The weaker ones will be held in this room for doctors or physicians in the castle to examine or check on them. Only the stronger ones would have to continue with the journey. And so after the sorting has been done, the stronger ones wouldn't move back towards the main entrance. No, they would exit the dungeon through an underground passage. Behind this wall, there was an underground passage, very big and very wide, about 70 meters from this point. Only the stronger ones would have to make their way through the tunnel. They walk through till they get to the door of no return, where the women can join them. They all move straight into the ships. The tunnel itself, it has been blocked by the British in 1833. For that reason, we cannot move out, we cannot move through this tunnel. However, when we step outside, we'll get the opportunity to see how big the tunnel is, where exactly the tunnel ends. But from this point, I'm sorry, we can't go through from this very point. But these are flowers or wreaths also in here. These were brought in here by Africans, African Americans, people from the Caribbean. They brought them in here to pay homage to their ancestors, to our brothers and sisters who lost their lives doing the trade. They mostly bring these flowers in here during Pan-African Historical Theater Festival, Panafest, or Emancipation Day. That is when these are normally brought in here. And in 2019, Ghana celebrated the year of return, of which many of these were also brought in here. But finally, this is a shrine, African traditional temple. In the olden days, before the Europeans had not introduced Christianity to Africans, nor the Arabs had not introduced Islam to Africans, we as Africans, we had our own way of communicating to the Supreme Being. We communicate to the Supreme Being through natural things like stones, rivers, mountains, trees. It is our belief that once we pray or worship through some of these natural phenomena, our petitions will get to the ancestral world. The ancestors, together with the deities, will carry our petitions to the Supreme Being. We as Africans believe that the ancestors and the deities are more closer to God than any other person. That was the mode of worship, and that is how we Africans communicate to the Supreme Being before the coming of the Europeans. However, in Cape Coast here, we have 77 of such shrines in the town, or 77 deities in the town. This is one of them. He is called Nana Tabre. Nana Tabre, that is the name of the deity. However, this shrine of this deity was on this very land before this whole edifice was built. But then after the Europeans acquired the land from the chiefs, they were denying the local people from worshiping from this side. They performed the sacrifice that took the shrine from here to another place. Later, when the trade ended in the castle, that is when they felt they need to bring it back to its original position. And so all that I'm trying to put across is that when the captives were in here, this wasn't here. It was only brought back when the trade ended in the castle. That is how come today we still see a shrine in here. It is still an active shrine for the indigenous people in the town. Any questions?
The alcohol.
Okay, so.
Yeah, but I isn't there some kind of, because who snaps owned by?
So, we as Africans, before we can communicate to the deities or the ancestors, we need to pray, and we pray by pouring libation, which the libation could be done with alcohol, hard liquor, just as you see over here.
Yeah, it could but it's the actual alcohol company that produces this. It's not Ghana, it's not African, is it?
No. Mm. No, I think it's a German company.
Like wine or appetition or something.
Yes,
why
we can.
So why is that not exhibited to them? Because these are foreign.
No, so most of the times, not necessarily. They might use this at initial stage, but once they get finished, they could fill it with any other local hard liquor, probably water in there.
Because most of those companies are built on slavery, so that's why.
Yes. I get a question.
But what and what cannot be done here?
It's like why are we using their products and not our own products?
Yeah.
for such.
Because I know still now to this day they still offer them, they want to buy land, they want to be cheap, and most of the stuff is the stuff that is actually.
It is a law in Ghana, that's by one problem.
So they can just use our own stuff. It's just a start.
Right.
Okay.
I wish they would never sell any land to any Chinese or any.
What and what cannot be done here?
Like,
and then what is allowed to be asked of the ancestors?
Okay.
I don't get your question.
What and what is allowed to be asked from the ancestors? Is there things that are limited for them to answer, or?
So any problem at all?
Anything at all?
You can tell them.
Okay. Very well, it's very, 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 very emotional. You just have to get it. So if you're watching this video, kindly subscribe, like this video, share this video.